السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Welcome to another session of Ask an Imam. My name is Farhan Iqbal and I am a missionary of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. This is a live program and you can ask any questions about Islam, the Ahmadiyya Muslim community or other world religions. Answers are provided in light of resources found on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. That is www.alislam.org, alislam.org. That is the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. You are watching this program live on multiple platforms. That includes Twitter or X and Facebook and YouTube. If you are on X, you can use the live stream itself to ask your questions. If you are on Facebook, you can use the comment section to ask your questions. And if you are on YouTube, you can use the live chat feature to ask your questions. On a desktop or a laptop, the live chat appears to the right of the video. And if you are using a mobile device, it should appear underneath the video, depending on how you're looking at the video. Otherwise, if it's in landscape mode, the live chat should appear right within the live stream itself, the video itself. I wanted to talk a little bit about the Al-Islam design, and that's just a general topic for today. It's I haven't picked a particularly religious topic for today, but as you know, this is an Ask an Imam, where you can ask questions about Islam, the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, faith matters, religious topics is what we discuss in this program. But since the answers that are provided to you are in light of resources found on the official website, I wanted to take this opportunity to talk about the Al-Islam design. As it is possible that in the near future, this design may change, but there are multiple features that we use often on the Al-Islam page. So if you go to the main page, there is the ticker, of course, when, you know, right here, there's a banner which changes. There are multiple options at the very top, right? Islam, Ahmadiyya, Holy Quran, Holy Prophet, Promised Messiah, Khilafat Library. Out of these, the one that I most often use is, frequently use, are two. Two links. One is the Promised Messiah, because it's very easy to click on Promised Messiah and find everything you need about the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, brief information about him, and then some documentaries, his signs, claims, message. In my Ask an Imam programs, in fact, it's been 5 years that since I've been doing these programs, and I've often come to this page. And right here are the English books of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam. Right. And this list keeps growing. Even recently, the Ahmadiyyas and the Ariyas of Qadian, bounties of the gracious God, have been added to this page. Articles about the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam. And then there's some more links which are further articles about the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam. One article that I had a chance to write is right here, establishing the truthfulness of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, from the Holy Quran. And it is another one of those pages that I've often visited. To basically answer in response to those who ask about the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, the evidence of his claims from the Holy Quran, right? So this is these are some of the resources that I frequently use. Then another frequent one, if we go back to the homepage, is the library option. Under library, we have books. So I click on books often, and that gives me the option to find the author and the books that are listed under those authors. And then there are six main ones here, and then we have other authors and we have further books. This page is also going to probably change in the near future, where you will have more easier navigation of these books. And then we also have the library Friday sermon. That's also, I click on that often. And this is a design that was changed and enhanced not too long ago. And it is very easy now to go through it and to see the notes of the transcript of the Friday sermon. Right, this page used to be very different in the past, but now it has been thoroughly updated. Right, and it is very helpful. And there are multiple features here that you should know about if you don't. For instance, on this page, you have the summary. Then you have the full text, right? Which right now is not available for the latest sermon, but if you go to the older sermons, you will find the full text. And then the Urdu khutbah page is also there. English summary, Bawakile Ala, Bengali summary is also here. You have it in video and audio format as well. So if you don't want to use too much internet, you can use the audio format. And then there are the other languages that you can select from here, right? The default one being Urdu, right? And then we have the Friday Sermon podcast. I use this often, but because I'm already subscribed to it on my phone, I don't have to go from here. But if you are not yet subscribed, you can use this link to find how you can subscribe to it, right? So if you go into the podcast, so it's brought us to the podcast service page, which has multiple options of its own. So that includes Friday Sermons by Khalifatul Masih. So whatever phone you have, you can, if you have an Apple phone, you can find the Friday Sermons by Khalifatul Masih in your phone, in the podcast app. You can use it. You can find them also on Spotify and Google. And then you have another podcast channel for Keynote Addresses by Hazrat Khalifatul Masih that you can consult and you can also subscribe to those pages. Audiobooks is something on an Apple device or an Android device. When you listen to a podcast audiobooks, the sound quality is amazing. So we have the Urdu ones and we have the English ones. This is the desktop version of this, but obviously on your phone it will look much better, and you have all these books that are constantly being added to our podcast page for the English audiobooks, right? And so these are some options that I've just, you know, by clicking around, you can find all these things I'm just showing you. If you just click around, if you just explore, there are lots of things on Al-Islam that many people don't know about. And it's good to sometimes just go on the website and to become comfortable with the design, with the links, with the different sections of the website, instead of, you know, most of us, I think, we just go to the website and we find what we're looking for, and that's what we use it for. But there are lots of other things that you can use this website for. Before I move on, just wanted to mention that this is an Ask an Imam, where you can ask any questions about Islam, the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, or other world religions. Answers are provided in light of resources found on the official website, that is www.alislam.org. alislam.org, that is alislam.org. Okay, I see one person has said salam. Walaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. All right, another person has asked this question. Okay, on this page it's not showing. So let me see what I can do here. It was only showing on this page. So let's use that page. Excuse me. The question is, I have a question that if it is okay if in dua we ask Allah to show me your sign, even if you have a firm belief in Allah. You know, asking Allah for a particular sign, it's okay. But what is discouraged by the Promised Messiah al-Islam in some of his writings is that we openly start asking for revelations to come down on us. Because there is a danger when someone asks Allah for a revelation to be sent down to them, there is a danger that that person is trying to... There's a danger of that person becoming arrogant. After having received that revelation, they might think that they have a very close relationship with God, and they might become arrogant because of it. And that could be harmful, that could be risky, that could create more problems for them. And so they have to be careful about this. If you look at the life of the prophets, if you look at the life of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, and I was just reading one of his texts a few minutes ago, where he was saying that I was such a private person. This is something that he says in his book, Ejaz-e Ahmadi. There's an Arabic poem which he has written at the end of that book. And one of the couplets says that I was such a private person that I did not even go out of my way to meet people. So even when people came looking for him, it was hard for them to find him because he was so secluded and so private about his life. But he says that it was Allah who told me to come forward and to deliver his message. And that's what he's doing. And so if you look at the prophets, they're all very humble. They're all very, very private people. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go to the cave of Hira, which was 3 miles approximately from Mecca. And so he, you know, went out of his way to be away from people and to be very private about his worship of Allah. And that's when he received his first revelation. So privacy and you can pray to Allah that for a sign, but at the same time you should also pray for Allah to not let any kind of arrogance dilute your intentions, right? So that's what is important. The other thing is that prophets are granted the power and the strength, I should say, not necessarily power, but the strength to bear revelations from God. And so that's also important. If you remember that from the Holy Quran, and let's see if I can find that verse, when it is recorded about Moses alayhi salam, where he asked Allah to see him. First of all, there's this chapter 2 verse 56, and remember when you said, so these are the people of Moses who are saying, oh Moses, we will by no means believe until we see Allah face to face. First of all, that was something that is not liked by Allah, because then فَأَخَذَتْكُمُ الصَّاعِقَةُ وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ, then the thunderbolt overtook you while you gazed, which was meant to say that, you know, so many signs have already come to them. Why are they continuously then asking to see Allah face to face? So that's something that was said to them. There is also another verse about Prophet Moses alayhi salam, asking for something, and then a sign came from God Almighty, and then it caused him to fall and to faint, basically, because he was asking for something that was possibly beyond his capacity to experience. So we have to also make sure that we are not asking Allah for something. I don't see that verse here because it's searching for the term Allah, and how about I search for the term Moses? Oh, even Moses, there are multiple verses. So it will take me some time to find that. There's also, I think, mention of a mountain in that verse. And the word mountain also appears many times. What if I say Moses and a mountain and Moses? Right, so that's also, okay, so but I found it. There you go. So the first verse, I was just looking at the 197 verses and I thought that maybe I still haven't found it, but there it is. In chapter 7 verse 144, it says, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ وَلَمَّا جَاءَ مُوسَى لِمِيقَاتِنَا وَكَلَّمَهُ رَبُّهُ قَالَ رَبِّ أَرِنِي أَنْزُرِ إِلَيْكَ. And when Moses came at our appointed time and his Lord spoke to him, he said, my Lord, show thyself to me that I may look at thee. He replied, thou shalt not see me. قَالَ لَنْ تَرَانِي وَلَاكِنْ انْزُرْ إِلَى الْجَبَلِ. But look at the mountain. If it remains in its place, then thou shalt see me. فَإِنْ اسْتَقَرَّ مَكَانَهُ فَسَوْفَ تَرَانِي. Then thou shalt see me. فَلَمَّا تَجَلَّى رَبُّهُ لِلْجَبَلِ جَعَلَهُ دَكَّا وَخَرَّ مُوسَى صَائِقًا. And when his Lord manifested himself on the mountain, he broke it into pieces and Moses fell down unconscious. And when he recovered, he said, Holy art thou, I turn towards thee and I am the first to believe. So this is the key verse. I recommend that you read the commentary of this verse as well to understand this verse better. And for those of you who want to know how to search for these kinds of things, I've used a search term that I recently learned, which is and. I haven't experimented how well this works on Al-Islam, but in other search engines, it is commonly understood that if you put and between two words, then the search results that will come have to have both the word mountain and Moses. So you're trying to tell the search engine to give me both the terms before and after the term and, right? So there, the word and is not being searched. The words mountain and Moses are being searched. And luckily, it has shown me, I can look at these search results, and at least the first two search results have the word Moses and mountain in them. So that means it is following the search engine, you know, whatever coding they have done behind this to make sure that these two terms are showing up. And I think the rest of the search results will only have either Moses or mountain as a term, right? So this is one trick you can use. There are other tricks, but I haven't tried those yet on the Al-Islam search or the Quran search. But for our purposes, for right now, it has worked and it has shown me the result that I was looking for. This is in chapter 7, verse 144. So read the commentary. So we should always make sure. And if you don't find the direct commentary of this, actually, I do find a detailed paragraph here. Read the verses before, the commentary of the verses before and after as well. That should also help you. So the idea is that that we shouldn't ask Allah for something that we would not be capable of experiencing or not have the power to experience. And there are so many signs that Allah keeps showing us regardless. There are so many, if you read the books of the promised Messiah, al-Islam, if you read his book, Haqiqatul Wahi, it has numerous signs that Allah showed him. And some of those signs are prophecies about the future, and those prophecies are being fulfilled in our lifetimes. So we can look towards that as well as a source of satisfaction for what we are asking Allah for. Okay, another question. This person has also said salam. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. How is Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salam the second coming of Krishna alayhi salam? And how does that fulfill the prophecy in Hindu from the Hindu perspective? I've done an Ask an Imam program where I think you or someone else asked this question about Krishna. And so I've looked at some of the references to Krishna in Haqiqatul Wahi, where the promised Messiah Islam said that he is the second coming of Krishna as well. And so you can look at those references and see how the promised Messiah Islam has explained it. As I said, you can go to alislam.org, download the book Haqiqatul Wahi, and search for the term Krishna, and you will get some answers. But if your question is, how does that fulfill the prophecy from the Hindu perspective? Our goal is never to prove something from another religion's perspective. First of all, you need to understand, when we say that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came in accordance with the prophecies of the Bible, then we are not trying to prove from the Christian perspective, because the Christian perspective has a different perspective on the same verses. What we are trying to do is to challenge their perspective and show them that if you look at it from an objective perspective, if you look at those prophecies regarding Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Bible, if you look at those verses, they cannot be understood or interpreted to mean to be in reference to anyone other than the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. if you look at Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15 to 20, for instance, and Hazrat Khalifatul Masih al-Awwal radiallahu anhu has done a detailed analysis of those verses, and he has proven 9 points in verses 15 to 20. We have 9 points of prophecy that are all fulfilled in the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and there is no one else who ever came in the history of humankind who fulfills the criteria that is found in those verses, right? So by saying this, we are challenging the Christian perspective, we are challenging the Jewish perspective, and asking them to look at it as objectively as they can. I mean, perfect objectivity is not possible, but as objectively as possible. That is our tabligh, that is our preaching, that is our da'wah. We are taking the message to them and asking them to look at those references. In particular to the Hindu perspective, I personally am not an expert in their books and their prophecies. I've studied the Bible to some extent, and I can answer that. But that, which is why I gave the example from the Bible. But for the Hindu perspective, we will have to look at their books, the original context, what are those prophecies, and how they are fulfilled. There is some research done on this. I'm not sure if that research is currently available on alislam.org or not. But let's say if we type in Krishna and Hindu scriptures, I'm not sure if that will reveal any. Okay, so there is the discussion on Hinduism by Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Rabi, rahimahullah ta'ala. See if that gives you some references that you can go to. That itself, this chapter itself, should help you study this better. Words of God and religions, the promised Messiah, prophecies fulfilled. Right? So you can look at this article, The Promised Messiah, Prophecies Fulfilled, and see if you can find some details about that. So there are some references here, but of course we will have to go into more detail to see what exactly the Hindu scriptures say and how exactly we can present it to our Hindu brothers. So look at these options and see if you can present this better. I didn't look at this later chat from you, which says, does the Bible say there will be a prophet in the end times as the Messiah? Or does it say Jesus will come back metaphorically? In the Bible, does it mention Jesus alayhi salam died a natural death? I'll answer your last question first. So the Bible does not say that Jesus died. The Bible, more particularly the Gospels, right, which are books, four books in the beginning of the New Testament, which are about Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. So there is some mention of Jesus dying at the cross in the Gospels, but after that, they mention that he reappeared and he was alive. And then after that, they are silent. There are a couple of Gospels which do mention his ascension, but scholars have recently stated that those verses which speak about the ascension of Jesus to heaven as inauthentic. So in fact, there is no Gospel that clearly says that Jesus ascended to heaven. The Gospels do mention that he died while on the cross, but then by the fact that he reappeared later, it casts doubt on whether he was truly dead or not. So if you read the biblical narrative itself, the gospel narrative itself, you will have doubts about how could you say that Jesus died when he reappeared later on. Christians would interpret that to say that he died on the cross and then he was resurrected, right? But resurrection is something that is a belief that is not, you cannot prove it from history. You can just look at the narrations, historical narrations about Jesus and interpret them from a belief perspective. So what is our perspective? What is the Ahmadiyya Muslim perspective? The Ahmadiyya Muslim perspective is that Jesus did not die And this was something that was probably a rumor or probably something that was said about Jesus that he has died. But in fact, he had only become unconscious and then taken down from the cross while breathing, while alive. And his body was hidden in a tomb. And it was secretly, he was given some treatment, and secretly he was removed from that tomb overnight, right? So Jesus was put on the cross on Friday, and because of the Jewish law, he had to be brought down a few hours later. You know, it could be even, you know, anything between 2 or 3 hours or maybe 4 or 5 hours. We don't know, because the different gospels say different things. But, you know, within a few hours, he was taken down, because by Friday sunset, nobody was allowed to be on the cross according to Jewish law. So he was taken down at that very quickly after having been put on the cross. And he was, from our perspective, he was the best explanation for the historical evidence is that he was alive and he did not die on the cross. And then he was taken to a tomb. And there was a big storm, and people had dispersed at that time. Nobody was there. There were only a handful of people there. And it's possible that he was taken to the tomb. The tombs in those areas in those times were not like the tombs we have today. They were basically like rooms, like a basement room, or even above the surface room. So he was taken to a room which was supposed to be a tomb, but he was given treatment. And he went there Friday night, obviously badly injured, but not completely dead. And he stayed there, possibly in the tomb, getting treatment all day Saturday, with little to no knowledge of, you know, others. And on Saturday night, possibly with the help of some others, he was taken out of the tomb, you know. And there's mention in the Bible, I believe it is in the Gospel of John, which says that Nicodemus, who was a secret disciple of Jesus, went to Pilate, who was the governor of that area, the Roman governor, and asked him for the body of Jesus, and Pilate allowed it, which is strange. Why would they allow it? It was allowed. And, you know, Nicodemus did come. That means that he did come in possession of the body, which was Jesus Christ, and possibly he was alive at that time. And not possibly, but from our perspective, he was alive at that time. And he was removed, and he was taken out of the tomb. And, you know, the next day, later on Sunday, you know, in the morning, when the woman came to the tomb, they found it empty. And after that, he appeared alive to his disciples, and you know, he migrated from that area because it was no longer safe for him to be there. So this is what our perspective is. And I know you have asked 3 questions, and I've answered only one of them. So in order to save time, someone has pointed out that the book Jesus in India has the explanation. So yeah, I've given you a quick rundown of this, but you should go to alislam.org and search Jesus in India, and it will give you an account of all these details, and it's available in multiple formats, including audiobook. All right, so that should answer your question. Your other question was, does the Bible say that there will be a prophet in the end times as Messiah? I showed you a few minutes ago an article by Ataul Wahid about prophecies regarding the Messiah. Have a look at that, because he has talked about the prophecies regarding the coming of the Messiah according to the Bible. And yes, according to Christians, the interpretation of those prophecies is that Jesus will literally come back. But our perspective is that it was always metaphorical, because according to the Bible, even Elijah was supposed to come, right? Elijah was supposed to return before Jesus. But when this question was put to Jesus, he said, well, those prophecies have been fulfilled in John the Baptist. So the return of Elijah occurred metaphorically in the person of John the Baptist. So according to the biblical evidence, these prophecies about the return of prophets are meant to be taken metaphorically. And so when Jesus, if there is a prophecy about Jesus coming back, it is also meant to be taken metaphorically. Okay? So I hope that answers your question. But Jesus in India is the first book I would recommend for you to learn more about this subject. Person is saying, Assalamu alaikum, I am an Ahmadi Muslim, Alhamdulillah, but would love for you to explain Hazur's guidance on helping the conflict apart from prayer, of course. What can we do to help? Hazur-e Anwar, may Allah be his helper, has, of course, said that we should pray for the Palestinians who are suffering in the current war. And I've done a couple of live streams recently on this topic. If you want to go back and listen to those as well. But of course, we can reach out to our politicians. We can reach out to our, you know, you can reach out whichever country you're from, reach out to the Jamaat in your country and ask them the protocols and the procedures within which you can reach out to the politicians of your country and ask them to raise a voice. Currently, we are asking for one thing, which is a ceasefire. Right, so we need a ceasefire immediately, because right now too many civilians are dying, and there's very little evidence that when neighborhoods are bombed, that there are some militants there as well. At least that evidence is not being shown; it is just being stated. And the fact of the matter is, and nobody can deny this fact, and there's clear evidence of this, that thousands of children have died. And those children are obviously just the victims. They are not militants. They are not terrorists. And so it is very unfortunate. So we have to reach out to our here in Canada, we have a system where we reach out to our MPs, federal MPs, and we reach out to them. We are trying to persuade them to call for a ceasefire, right? So prayers and actions together, we are trying to do as best as we can. But the best person to respond to your question would be whichever Jamaat you are from, you can reach out to your local Jamaat and ask them what procedures are to be followed. Waqas has asked, are these stories authentic? I'm not sure which stories you're referring to, but if you're talking about the Gospels that I was discussing at length earlier, then the Gospels and the stories about Jesus are not fully reliable, because there are mistakes in them, there are discrepancies in them. It's possible some of the stories are written in a way that they have been heavily exaggerated. However, there is some truth, some historical truth within those stories. The stories were probably distorted or partially changed. Some details here and there were changed, but the general outline of the story looks historically plausible, and so we accept that. But from a historical point of view, we have to assess those stories and see what is more reliable than and what is not so reliable. And scholars work, even non-Muslim scholars work through the stories of the Gospels and try to see which one of those stories are more historically accurate. And they have their reasons, they have their research, and why this is to be taken in a certain way. The comment here, a couple of comments I have here, and then I will conclude. This book, Jesus in India, is an exceptional book covering all aspects of Jesus' death from Christian and Muslim view. Perfect, that's true. And as I've shown you, you can consult it. Jazakallah for that comment. Waqas has now sent another comment that, is it true that Mirza Ghulam Ahmad initially believed that Jesus was in heaven alive and only later learned that Jesus was dead? This means that the Quran is not explicit and clear about this matter. That is not true. Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salam initially has written in one of his earlier books, or rather one of the earliest books, that Jesus Christ will descend from heaven. But later he explained that this is an opinion of this was the opinion of the Muslims in general. So when he was writing that opinion, it was just in light of what the Muslims generally believed. However, when he received revelations from God and clear revelations from God, and when he studied the Holy Quran in response to this question about the death of Jesus, it was crystal clear that the Quran states that Jesus Christ has passed away. On alislam.org, if you type in the search bar, 30 verses proving the death of Jesus Christ, you will come across an article that lists 30 verses that have been discussed by the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, that categorically state that Jesus Christ, alayhi salam, has passed away. So have a look at those. This does not mean that the Quran is not explicit or clear about this matter. The Quran is very clear. The Quran is explicit. As human beings, we make interpretations of the Quran. Sometimes we think that the Quran says something, but then when we do our research, when we consult the Quran at length, we come to realize the Quran has clearly stated something different from our opinion. So we have to turn back to the Quran as much as we can. All of us, and even today, those who believe that Jesus is alive need to look at the evidence and then decide for themselves. And I'm sure that if you look at it from an objective point of view, you will come to the conclusion that Jesus Christ, alayhi salam, has passed away. Last comment I'm going to take, or question rather, is there a feeling in your heart where you know your prayer is accepted before it actually happens? It is sometimes possible that Allah grants you a comfort in your heart, which makes you feel that the prayer will be accepted, and it does happen. And it is possible that that prayer is accepted and later on, right? So it's possible that that kind of comfort is granted. Ultimately, it is up to Allah what He makes us experience. Sometimes the prayer is not accepted, but that comfort of the heart that is granted to us, it makes us feel that what we are praying for was probably not good for us, and Allah did not accept the prayer, but He will grant us something in exchange for it, which is better for it, which is better than that. So that is also possible. So prayer is something that we should solely rely on. There is a book, and I will show it to you, that is available on Al-Islam that talks about prayer. Is entitled Blessings of Prayer, right? Barakatu Dua, and you can read this book in multiple formats that talks about the philosophy of prayer. So it's a strongly recommended book if you want to learn on this subject more. All right, Jazakallah. I will end here. I really appreciate all of you who joined this program and asked all these questions. It is always a pleasure and a humbling experience to answer these questions. I hope they were helpful for you. Please remember me and the alislam.org team in your prayers. Jazakumullah and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.